Hello. This is the 10th in the History of Jazz course, and today we're going to be concerned with novelty ragtime. Zez Confrey, Edward Elzier Confrey, that is, born in Peru, Illinois, April 3rd, 1895, died in Lakewood, New Jersey, November 22nd, 1971. Zez Confrey created a style of ragtime which became known as the novelty piano solo. While the novelty compositions were of a more complex character, the harmonies were also more daring, with the melody taking a back seat. So successful were his novelty rags that other pianists began composing in this new idiom, devising intricate patterns. Although a prolific piano roll artist and composer, Confrey made few solo recordings. His most famous, as well as his first novelty rag, is Kitten on the Keys, and we shall now hear Zez Confrey playing Kitten on the Keys. Zez Confrey himself, in 1921, playing his, at that point, revolutionary new conception of ragtime, the novelty rag. Because Confrey was a piano roll arranger and performer, primarily, this gave him the chance to experiment with all sorts of tricks and breaks. Confrey had a classical music training at the Chicago Musical College, run by Florin Ziegfeld Sr., which was comparable to the Juilliard School today in classical training. And while he was learning, growing up in classical music, the big thing was the French Impressionist School of Claude Debussy and Maurice Ravel, and we can hear some of that in Confrey's compositions. The very first composition in this new idiom that Confrey created came about in 1918, and he first recorded it on a piano roll that was released in July of 1918 for the QRS Piano Roll Company. It was called My Pet. Sid Williams was a black pianist from the Midwest who, during the late 20s, recorded a few novelty solos. The majority of them were Confrey compositions, and he treated them uncommonly. In his version of My Pet, the first of Confrey's novelty rags, Williams, with great strength and feeling, plays this piece in a slow, deliberate manner, which allows us to hear all of its complexities in detail without sacrificing the overall flow of the piece. Let us now listen to Zez Confrey's My Pet, as performed by Sidney Williams. Performance, although very unusual, of My Pet, Zez Confrey's first novelty rag, as performed by Sid Williams. The next Confrey piece is really a showstopper. He wrote it in 1923 to illustrate the effects of the Nickelodeon, or the mechanical jukebox, the automatic player piano type of device where you put a nickel in, and then a tune would play, and they would have all sorts of instruments, not only the piano, but there would be a drum, and there might have been a violin or a xylophone attachment added. But like all mechanical contrivances, it would break down and sort of sound awful. And so Confrey, when he was touring vaudeville, wrote this piece as a showstopper, played straight, however, by me, the tune Nickel in the Slot. Zez Confrey's 1923 composition, Nickel in the Slot, as performed by me. The next Confrey piece was one that he wrote in 1922, and it's called Coaxing the Piano, this time performed by the Canadian virtuoso Willie Eckstein. Eckstein performing Zez Confrey's Coaxing the Piano. Did you happen to notice a similarity between Kitten on the Keys, Nickel in the Slot, and Coaxing the Piano? I hope you did, because they're essentially the same piece, the same rhythms, that is, and the same harmonies. But melodically, if you can use the word melodically here, They were different. This is to a tribute of Zez Confrey, the creator of the novelty rag and a genius at this kind of composition. Not far behind Confrey was Roy Bargy, who was born in Michigan on July 31st, 1894, and who died sometime in 1974. Bargy was a professional pianist too, classically trained, and as he once wrote to me, in those days, if you didn't have a lot of money and you couldn't study abroad, why, you better give up the idea of a classical profession. And since Bargy's parents were middle class, not very well-to-do people, they couldn't afford to send him abroad for the final study, and so that he had to abandon his ideas of becoming a concert pianist and went into popular music. He became the pianist and arranger for the Benson Orchestra in Chicago, and he also got with a piano roll company. When Confrey recorded for QRS, Bargy recorded for Imperial. And at Imperial, the manager was another great pianist, arranger, and then finally orchestra leader by the name of Charlie Strait. And in 1922, both Strait and Bargy started composing novelty rags once they saw how popular Confrey's were. And so I'd like us to hear a tune written by both Strait and Bargy called Nice and Nifty. One of the things, in addition to being unusual, about these piano solos, these novelty rags, is that the titles were awfully cute. For instance, our engineer Tom Arsenault didn't quite recognize the fact that this was called Nice and Nifty, possibly because the spelling was K-N-I-C-E and K-N-I-F-T-Y. The K's, of course, being silent. Let's now listen to Willie Eckstein, whom we just heard doing Confrey's Coaxing the Piano, and it's a great way to hear not only the two composers, but one performer's interpretations of them. Willie Eckstein now doing Roy Bargy and Charlie Strait's Nice and Nifty. Eckstein doing Nice and Nifty, the Roy Bargy novelty rag. And because that was such an interesting and unusual composition, How about another one by Roy Bargy and Charlie Strait? This was the first of theirs, in fact, in November of 1921, and it's performed by a contemporary pianist who happened to have been with Paul Whiteman's orchestra. And so, by a strange coincidence, a few years later, was Roy Bargy the chief pianist for Paul Whiteman. The pianist now is Henry Lang. Henry Lang was a contemporary of Bargy's, also born in 1894, happily still with us, living in Toledo, Ohio. Let's listen to his contemporary recording, then, of Rough and Ready. That's spelled R-U-F-E-N-R-E-D-D-Y, by Roy Bargy and Charlie Strait. Was Henry Lang doing the Bargy Strait composition Rough and Ready. Roy Bargy was quite an unusual composer, and he was a very fine pianist, but others seem to like to interpret his works, and so why don't we hear one of the finest interpreters, Ray Turner, who also coincidentally happened to be a pianist with Paul Whiteman's orchestra. Paul Whiteman, of course, had the finest orchestra of the 20s, and then 30s, and then 40s, and he was probably the greatest of all dance band leaders, and he had the finest musicians. His orchestra finally numbered around 50 people, when most dance bands started off with 10 pieces, 9 or 10 pieces, and then gradually, with the big band era of the swing age, got to 14 or 15 pieces, Paul Whiteman had close to 50. He was the greatest, the biggest. Yes, he was over 6 feet tall, weighed over 300 pounds, was large, but also had a large appetite for music. And so Bargy and Lang and Ray Turner and a whole mess of people played for Paul Whiteman at one time or another. Ray Turner turns to Roy Bargy's 1922 composition called Jim Jams. Fabulous arrangement of a great composition of Roy Bargy's, Jim Jams. For our last survey of Roy Bargy and his compositions, we'll hear a piano duo, quite unusual in those days. In fact, it's quite unusual today. But from a contemporary recording by the marvelous studio musicians Frank Banta and Cliff Hess, they do Roy Bargy's Slipover. That's spelled S-L-I-P-O-V-A. Slipover.
Thank you.
That was Slip Over, the Roy Bargee composition of 1921, as performed by Frank Banta and Cliff Hess in a contemporary recording. The next composer we're going to be hearing, composer-pianist, we heard Zuz Confrey and Roy Bargee, and now we'll hear from the Englishman Billy Mayerl, born in London on May 31st, 1902, died in Beaconsfield, England, March 25th, 1959, was one of the greatest composer-pianists ever. His compositions easily can take the place and stand next to Zuz Confrey and Roy Bargee, the American masters. Mayerl was a phenomenal pianist who also composed and conducted for shows. But we're interested in his novelty rags. And in 1925, he recorded and published and composed The Jazz Master. Fine introduction to Billy Mayerl, both the composer and master pianist. He possessed every gift essential to the true musician, a superb touch, perfect pitch, and a supreme skill for improvisation. If he did play a passage which was dissonant, he could easily weave it back to the most melodic phrase. Lawrence Saville, director of Kramer's, the music publishers of St. Martin's Lane in London, was chatting recently about Billy. He said, "We live practically next door to his house. What a superlative pianist. Perfect, though sometimes I wished he would play a wrong note." Let's listen to another one of Billy's fabulous and unique compositions. Another novelty rag, this one called Railroad Rhythm. Thank you. And that was the absolutely outstanding Billy Merrill, English pianist, composer extraordinaire, doing Railroad Rhythm, another one of his fabulous novelty rags. And now on to someone else, a composer certainly of novelty rags, a performer certainly of novelty rags, but not a pianist. One of the most remarkable people was Harry Reeser, the greatest banjoist in the world. Unlike other banjo virtuosi, Reeser's first instrument was the guitar, which he learned at the age of 5, playing a specially built model to accommodate hands which were unusually small for his age. It was not until many years later that he learned the banjo. Born on January 17, 1896, in Piqua, Ohio, Reeser early showed his love for stringed instruments. As he was progressing on the guitar, he learned to play the violin and cello. It wasn't until he found out that the banjo was popular with audiences in Broadway cafes and restaurants, like the famed Rector's, that he investigated that instrument. Inspired by the kings of the five-string banjo, Wes Ossman and Fred Van Epps, Reeser, at age 16, mastered the intricacies of first the five-string, then the plectrum, and finally the tenor banjo in, if you'll pardon the pun, record time. Coming to New York City in 1921 after playing throughout the Midwest in dance bands, he quickly joined such diverse recording groups as those headed by Joe Samuels, Milo Riga, Mike Markell, and Nathan Glantz. His first solos, recorded in 1922, were his own compositions. Let's hear his 1926 composition now. It is a great novelty rag. Played by Harry Reeser, it's called Lollipops. Gentlemen, is the banjo artistry of Harry Reeser, doing his own novelty rag, Lollipops. Novelty ragtime, of course, was created and developed by those hand-played piano roll artists who had to make a full rich arrangement for rather than the thin sounding pop songs then in vogue in the 20s. Taking their unusual tricks, they put together an extremely complex rhythmic and harmonic series of progressions which demanded the greatest technical skill to perform. Reeser quickly challenged these piano masters as he composed equally difficult ragtime solos, but for the tenor banjo, normally regarded as basically a rhythm instrument. His technique was overwhelming, and he created the impression of playing on two banjos at the same time, with the melody on one and an even steady rhythm on the other. A similar effect, also on many of his records, is today referred to as cross-picking. It is acknowledged to be one of the most difficult picking patterns. And now for another rag performed and composed by Harry Reeser is his 1930 novelty rag called Cracker Jack. Novelty rag called Cracker Jack. Thank you. was Harry Reeser playing his own composition, the novelty rag Cracker Jack. On to a couple of assorted pianist composers now in the novelty rag idiom. The black composer-pianist from Wilmington, Ohio, Clarence Jones, who was born on August 15, 1889, died in New York City on June 1, 1949. His 1923 piece, he was also in with the Imperial Recording Studios, the piano roll people in Chicago, at the same time that Roy Bargy was there. And in fact, they were friends. In fact, they took ideas from one another. And Clarence Jones was extremely influential, as he was the teacher of Jimmy Blythe, whom we'll be hearing later on in the series. So here now is Clarence Jones doing his wonderful novelty rag called Modulations. Show on Novelty Ragtime would be complete without listening to the fabulous Rube Bloom, who was a native New Yorker, born in the city on April 24, 1902, died there in September of 1973. He was a master. He was sort of the second guard. As Zez Confrey and Roy Bargy were the first, so then were Billy Merrill and Rube Bloom the second creations. In 1926, Bloom came forth with his Spring Fever, as we'll now hear him perform. was the incomparable Rube Bloom doing his Spring Fever.